Hey everyone, welcome to my channel. In today's session, I'll be teaching about what exactly is microservices, what is continuous integration, what is continuous delivery and continuous deployment, what is exactly infrastructure as a code and what is Terraform. And then we'll learn about what are the tools that AWS gives us for the CI/CD. And at the end, I will show you a microservices CI/CD demo with AWS tools and Terraform, okay? But before that, if you didn't subscribe to my channel yet, do subscribe to the channel and click on the bell icon. Now I have done it, let's get started. Now the very basic question, what exactly is microservices? So the microservices architecture is a design approach to build a single platform as a set of small applications or services. Each service runs in its own process and communicates with other services through a well-defined interface using a lightweight mechanism, typically a HTTP-based application programming interface or API. Microservices are built around the business capabilities. Each service is scoped to a single purpose. You can use different framework and programming languages to write microservices and deploy them independently as a single service or as a group of services. Now, let's understand what exactly is continuous integration or CI, we call in short. So, continuous integration or CI is a software development practice where developers regularly merge their code changes into central repository, after which automated build and tests are run. The key goal of continuous integration are to find and address bugs quicker, improve software quality, and reduce the time it takes to validate and release new software updates. So you can speed up your development. That's what it can do, okay? But in more simple words, continuous integration is a practice of automating integration of code changes from multiple contributors. So suppose I and my colleagues are working in a project, everyone making changes. So each time everyone making changes, that code must get validated before it gets to the staging server. And it's a primary dev practice allowing developers to frequently merge their code changes into the central repository where the build and tests are run. So that's how useful it is. And a very simple diagram you can see in the top, that where developers are pushing the code in the central repository, and there is CI server which running the test and making the build of that. Okay, now that you have learned what exactly is the continuous integration, let's learn about what is exactly continuous delivery and deployment. So what is continuous delivery? Continuous delivery is a software development practice where code changes are automatically built, tested and prepared for a release to the production. It expands upon continuous integration by developing all code changes into a testing environment and or to production environment after the build stage. When continuous delivery is implemented properly, developers will always have a development ready built artifact that has passed through a standardized test process. Okay. Now, what is exactly continuous deployment? So continuous deployment is a software release process that uses automated testing to validate if changes to a code base are correct and stable for immediate autonomous deployment to the production environment. Now, in your mind, there will be some confusion. Then what exactly is the difference between continuous delivery and continuous deployment? Now, there is one single tiny difference. You can see in the diagram below. In the continuous delivery, you will see code automatically getting tested and built, then it pushing to the staging server. And then there is manual approval state and could be any other step, and then only it will go to the production. But in the case of continuous deployment, there is no such manual approval. Like if the code is done with the testing, build and staging, all fine, then it will automatically move to the production server. Okay, so there is no manual approval in the continuous deployment, and there is a manual approval step needed in the continuous delivery. And that is the main difference between the continuous delivery and continuous deployment. I hope you can understand now. Okay. So now we have learned what exactly is microservices, what is CI/CD. It's time to understand about the infrastructure as a code and Terraform part. Okay. So what exactly is infrastructure as a code? Infrastructure as a code, or IAC in short, is a practice in which infrastructure is provisioned and managed using the code and software development techniques such as version control and continuous integration. Now you already know about continuous integration because we just covered, right? The cloud's API-driven model enable developers and system administrators to interact with infrastructure programmatically and at scale instead of needing to manually configure and set up the resources, right? So that engineers can interface with the infrastructure using code-based tools and treat infrastructure in a manner similar to how they treat the application code. And just because infrastructure is defined as code, Infrastructure and server can quickly be deployed using standards pattern, updated with the latest patches and versions, or duplicated in repeatable ways. Okay, so just for example, I have an infrastructure in AWS in say a Mumbai region. Now I want to replicate the same thing in US or maybe in London, whatever region. Now think about the case. If it was manual, then you have to every time when you move to the new region, you have to manually configure everything. But what if it was a infrastructure as a code? So if you use a tools like Terraform or AWS CloudFormation, if you have written infrastructure as a code, then you would have simply just changing some few parameters, you could have deployed the same infrastructure, exact carbon copy in other region very easily. Right, and it makes your repeating manual tasks a lot less. Okay, so you have more time to develop and work on the business logic. Okay, now let's understand what exactly is Terraform. So Terraform is an infrastructure as a code tool that allows you to build, change and version infrastructure safely and efficiently. This includes low level components such as compute instances, storage and networking, as well as high level components such as DNS entries, SaaS features, etc. Terraform can manage both existing service provider and custom in-house solutions all. Okay, now if you don't know about Terraform, what it does, I have made a separate course for Terraform learners. It's a full free course. I will highly encourage you to learn that. You can click on the watch Terraform basic full course to watch the course, or you can continue watch this one and later you can follow that course. Okay, it's up to you. Now let's learn about what are the CI/CD tools and microservices tool offered by AWS. So very first is the continuous integration and continuous delivery tools. We have here AWS Code Pipeline. So AWS Code Pipeline we use for the workflow management for the CI/CD tools. We have AWS Code Build, we use for the build services. We have Code Deploy. Of course, by the name you can tell is for deployment services. We have Code Commit, which is ultimately a managed Git service where we store our codes, a kind of central repository for us. We have Code Star, which manage all these tools as a complete package kind of thing. Okay. Now let's talk about the microservice tools. So we have Elastic Container Service, which is in short AWS ECS, and Amazon Elastic Container Service is highly scalable, high performance container management service that support Docker containers and allow you to easily run application manage cluster of Amazon EC2 instances, or you might run serverless as well. And then we have AWS Lambda. AWS Lambda let you run your code without provisioning or managing your servers. With Lambda, you can run code for virtually any type of application or backend service, all with zero administration. Just upload your code and Lambda take care of everything required to run and scale your code with high availability. For this demo, we'll be utilizing Code Pipeline, Code Build, Code Commit, and ECS. Okay, let's get started. Now it's time to get our hands dirty with actual action. But before that, click on this declare link. It will direct you to the GitHub project page. And there you will see all the source code that you need to run this project, and you can follow along with me. Okay, let's first understand the scenario first, and then I will go through the source code, and after that we will cover the Terraform and we'll actually get the resources. So what is our scenario here? Suppose your company already have a ECS cluster where they're running three services. One is Node.js, one is Python, and one is Go. Now your company asks you to create a CI/CD pipeline, and that should be as an infra as a code, so that they want to create one such CI/CD pipeline in other region anytime. That should be happen quickly and you don't have to create from scratch. Okay, but before going to the solution, now let me explain the source code and the existing infra. Okay, so our existing code consists of one Node.js application. As I talked, it's a simple application you're calling is service one. As you can see it here, for the Node.js application we have three routes. That is in the root route, which is replying only OK. And you have services service one, which is simply saying this is a sample service, just to understand this is coming from the Node.js application. And we have the slash status, so you can check the health of this application. Okay. And you can see in the left side, the Docker file where we are utilizing the base image as Node.js 14. Then you are setting the work directory. Then we are copying the package and then running the npm installation. And you're exposing 5001 because you're running the Node.js service in port 5001. And then you come and you're starting the Node.js application. Similarly, we have for Python, you can see exactly same kind of logic where we're saying the API route, that is the root route, is also replying OK. The services service 2 saying this is a API response from the Python app. And then you can see there and status to check the health of this application. And in the Docker file, you can see from base image Python Alpine 3.7, we are copying the codes to the app and then setting the work directory. Then we're running the pip install dash r requirements to install all the dependencies, then you're exposing port 5002. Because you can see in the code, we're running the Python application in port 5002. That's why we expose the 5002 port. And you're setting entry point as index.py. Okay. And then you have our Go app. You can see again, same exact structure where we are specifying the requirements in the main.go. And there we are setting the routes just like the Node and Python app. In the Docker file, we're mentioning from base image Golang 1.16 Alpine. We are setting the work directory. We are copying the mode file. We are copying the sum file. And then we are running the mode download. Then copying all this application. Then we are copying all the Go binaries. And then running the app. Okay. And then you're exposing port 5003 because our Go application is listening on the port 5003. Okay. Now let me show you the folder structure so you can understand even better. Now let me explain the entire project structure and the source codes. Okay. This is the very first Node.js application, which is a very simple one. You can see here index.js. Index.js, we have port 5000 using. We're using Express.js module. And there is a root path. Then there is a services service one path, where we have this sample and source and service, just a sample text, and then the status, so that ELB can check the status, which is the Elastic Load Balancer target group, and check the application status to make sure the app is healthy. And we are just listening on the port that you define here, 5001. Okay. And for the Docker file, you can see we are utilizing which is 14. We are seeing the work directory. We are copying the package JSON, then installing all the dependencies. We're copying all the files, exposing port 5001 because we are listening on that port, and we're starting the Node.js application. That's what the Docker file is doing. And the packages, and we have all the dependencies. And all other apps, like there is Python, you can see again, same thing. We are utilizing the Flask module for the web part, and we're using in the root route, using just OK. In the services, service 2, we're saying this sample response on service 2. And then in the services, service 2 status, OK. Right? So these are all normal. Now, if we go down and check the requirements.txt, we are simply mentioning the Flask, okay? And in the Docker file, we're utilizing Python Alpine 3.7. We are copying all the files to the app directory. We are setting the app directory as a work directory. Then we are installing all the requirements. Then you're exposing port 5002. And then you are running the Python app using the Python, then index.py. And again, same way for the Go app, we have the Docker file. Can see here we have the domain.go file where we are running our HTTP APIs. You can see services service 3, and if you go down, services service 3 status for the load balancer health check, and you are listening on port 5003. So this is all already mentioned, and now we are maintaining all our Terraform codes in this Terraform infra development folder. In the variables, we are storing all the parameters. In the output, just for sample output, I have set this value. But the main codes are in the main.tf, and the variables.tf is the most important here, okay? And I will be explaining all that in greater details. But before that, let's understand our existing infrastructure. So as for our use case, suppose the client already have a ECS cluster, okay? So let's say if you go to ECS, so user has a cluster named microservices cluster, where the client running, say, three services, one Python service, I have already shown the code, one Node.js service and one Go app service. Okay. Now this, all these services running as a microservices utilizing the ELB. So let's go to ELB. So go to EC2, then go back to load balancers. You can see load balancer, and we have our application load balancer set here. You can see it here. And this is the DNS name. Let's copy it. And let's say service 1, and will give us sample API response on Node.js app service. Similarly, service 2, you can see it's saying sample response from the service 2, that is Python app. And similarly, that is 3, that is sample response from version 3. So our application are running all fine using the ECS. Our task is to create the CI/CD pipeline so developer can push the code, and it will, as soon as they push the code, it should update the apps. That's our requirement here. Okay. For that, we have to know about very important things. First, that this is the name, it will be required. Then the service names, Python app service, Node.js app service, and Go app service. Then the task definitions, because in the task definition, we will find out what is exactly the container name. So that is also required. Now we have to make sure we have a file called buildspec.yml and it's mostly the same thing. You can see the buildspec.yml file is same for the Node, same for the Python, and same for the Go. You can see it here. All is doing here, logging into AWS ECR, then setting the repository UI from the environment variable. So remember, we have to set the environment variables as well. Then you are starting the Docker build, then you are tagging the image, and after that build is done, we are pushing the image, and then you are writing a image definition file. This image definition file will be utilizing for the deployment, but when we cover the deployment, I'll be covering that as well. Okay, now that we have covered all the source codes, it's time to start with the Terraform integration. So for the Terraform integration, first we need the variables. So what are the variables? Let me show you. So these are all the variables that we'll be utilizing in our projects, and variables kind of parameter for our Terraform project. Okay, and we're assigning all the default values. First is the region, then environment, then the repository name for the Node application, and the branch name for the Node application, the repository name of the Python app, and the branch name of the Python app, then the Go app's repository name and the Go app branch name. Then we have artifact bucket name, so that whenever code pipeline runs, it generates the source artifact, it can generate the build artifact, and we need to store it somewhere, right? For that reason, we have S3 bucket, okay? And we are calling it Sandeep CICD artifact bucket, but you can change this to any name that you want for your use case, okay? Then we have AWS ECS cluster name. If you don't know about what is the name of your ECS cluster, you can simply go to here in the AWS console and ECS, then look for the ECS Elastic Container Service, and then this is the service name, okay? So for us, it's microservices cluster. Then the service name for the Node.js application, so Node app service, service name for the Python application, service name for the Go application. So we have all these variables that we need. Now the second step is to initialize the project. So for that, we have to make sure that Terraform, what is the minimum required version, the backend. If you don't want to store the Terraform state file locally, you should use the backend. And for that, you can use the Terraform Cloud, S3, Azure, whatever you used to or you are working on. Okay. For this project example, we are utilizing AWS S3. Okay. Now for that, you can see the minimum required version that you mentioned and all that you already mentioned, and you're utilizing AWS as our provider. Okay. So now let's try to do Terraform initialize. Simply come to the project and then go to the Terraform infra development and then Terraform init. Okay. And you can see initializing the backend, and it's just, it will initialize all the required resources. Okay. Mostly cases the backend and the provider. You can see it's already done initializing, and we have installed, okay, previously the AWS provider. Okay. Now simply come to the main.tf, and you can see at the very top, we are mentioning here the required version S3, and the provider you are mentioning AWS. Okay. And as a region, you can see the variable. Now this is the variable we are mentioning. Default value is AWS2, and in the main, we are mentioning that region as region is equal to var. So if you're using variable, yeah, you have to add a word called var, then the variable name. That's how we mention it. Okay. The third step is to create IAM roles and policies so that this can be utilized by the build project and the code pipeline project. Okay. And for this, all these policies, you can see above, all these are I have mentioned in the GitHub repo. So you don't have to memorize it. Just understand what are the permission that is required, and you can more fine tune it as per your requirement. Okay. So let me show you. Just go down. You can see IAM role. That is container app build. So the build project, I'm calling it app build project, container app build project, where I'm mentioning the name is this, and then assume role policy. And inside that, I'm mentioning what is the assume role policy first, and then this role policy, I'm saying AWS IAM role policy, container app build project role policy. Inside that, as a role, I'm mentioning the previously created AWS IAM role, that AWS IAM dot container app build project role. Let's see, AWS IAM role dot container app build project role dot name, and this name referred to this. You can see name to this container app build project role. So that policy will be referred to this particular IAM role. And there, what are the permission we are giving? We are giving the log access, we are giving the EC2 access, we are giving the EC2 create network interface access, we are giving all the S3 access. Now this I'm giving more just for because of demo, but for your use case, you can even fine tune as you like it. Okay. And you can see we're giving ECS access, we're giving SSM access because you're utilizing parameter store. We're using the decrypt access because you're passing some secure parameters. When I show the code pipeline section, I'll be explaining that all in greater details. Okay. The fourth step is to create the AWS code build project. You can see it here. In this step, we will add all the references to create AWS code build project in order to create updated Docker images and push it to AWS ECR. To create the builds, we need the builds.yml as I already explained what it is. And also you must make sure that privilege more is equal to true. Now let me show you the code so you can understand better way. So you can see it here. Resource, then AWS code build project, then container app build. Okay. And then you're mentioning the badge enable false. You can, now these are all options are configurable. You can enter as you like it. The name, the query timeout, the service role. Now this service role is very important. So here we are mentioning AWS IAM role, and this is referring to the previous role that you have created. AWS IAM role, container app build project role that we are mentioning here. See, AWS IAM role and container app build project role.arm. This ARN you are mentioning here, and the tags you can mention as many tags as you want. In the artifacts, now artifacts are the final binaries that need to be stored in S3, those things. Here, since you are utilizing the code build, that's why you don't need to enter other details. Okay. For the environment part, this is the environment, that is a build environment. You can see compute type, we are mentioning build general, one small image. We are mentioning this AWS code build standard 5.1. That is the Ubuntu build, then image pool credential code build, then privilege mode true, and this is the most important part, as I already mentioned, type is equal to Linux container. Now this all configuration, if you don't know where to find and all, you can simply go to Google and search for Terraform code build. Simply search for that and you can see code build project, all these references, you can find it here. Like what should be, what parameter, what is the meaning of that? See in environments part, you can say what are the build types. You can say what are the compute types available. All these details are available here. You don't have to look anywhere else. You can find it here itself. Okay, so understand that part very carefully. And you can see it here. After that, you are mentioning the logs. The CloudWatch log, I'm enabling that. AC log, I'm making it disabled. The source part, again source part, I'm mentioning the code pipeline. Now if you don't know what to mention and where to mention, you can see, you can simply come to the sources, copy the source keyword, and you can see the source part here and all the details mentioning here, like types, these are the available types: code commit, code pipeline, GitHub, GitHub enterprise, Bitbucket, S3, no source. Okay. So for us in this use case, it's code pipeline. Okay. Now the fifth step is to create the actual code pipeline. Okay. So you can see here, we are mentioning resource, AWS code pipeline, Python app pipeline. Now here we are creating three pipelines for three projects. Okay. Where we mentioning the name, the role ARN, the tag, the artifact store, that is where we are going to store it. So mentioning the role of the code pipelines to make sure this has a necessary access. Specify the artifact location. These are what we are doing here. Now in the next step, we'll be mentioning what is the stages. So normally there are source stage, the build stage, and the deploy stage. Now let us jump into the codes and explain greater depth. Okay. So just like the code build project, for the code pipeline also, we are creating the app code pipeline. You can see when naming it apps code pipeline, because for all the pipelines we'll be utilizing the same AWS IAM role, so you can reuse the component, and it is a very good example of that. You can see assume role policy, we are assuming the role of the code pipeline for the role. Then you are creating the IAM role policy, where you are mentioning all the permission that is required for this pipeline to work with our projects and ECS cluster. Then we are creating the bucket. You can see AWS S3 bucket, CI/CD bucket, where we'll be storing our artifacts, right? And see the variable utilizing here, artifact bucket store. So this is the bucket that we'll be utilizing, Sandeep CI/CD artifact bucket, that we'll be utilizing here, right? You can see the bucket name here, as we mentioned. The ACL access control list, we have to make sure it is not accessible to the public. The ACL is private, so only the proper person can have the access to this particular bucket. We are mentioning false true, so that when you run the Terraform destroy command, it should be deleted even if there is the content in this bucket. Otherwise, it will throw you error that is saying that this bucket is not empty. Okay, the versioning, you are enabling the versioning and you are mentioning the MFAT list is false. Okay, then you can see the actual pipeline code. See, AWS code pipeline for the, we are first creating for the node application. You can see node app pipeline. Then you are giving name as node app pipeline. In the role ARN, you are utilizing the IAM role that you have created for this pipeline. You can see AWS IAM, AWS IAM role, then apps code pipeline role dot ARN. So that ARN you supply as a role ARN here. Tags, you can mention the tags you like. In the artifact store, you are supplying the name of the bucket that you created. That is Sandeep CICD bucket. Okay, here. And we are mentioning the type as S3. Right now only S3 is supported. Then the stage. So first stage is the source stage. You can see source stage in the action, we are mentioning the category as source. Then in the configuration, branch name, we are giving the Node.js project branch name. In the repository name, we are giving the Node.js project repository name. That is our code commit repo. And input artifact, we are giving blank array. Then giving name as source. This source, the name of the output artifact will be the source artifact. The owner is AWS. The provider is code commit. Now this line is the most important line of this block. Okay, and if you don't know about all this provider, you can come to this page, AWS. You can see it's with action structure reference, where you have all the action references. So for us, this action reference is the provider, is the code commit. You can see simply come to the code commit, and if you click on that, you will see all the configuration. So for our, just for example, our configuration is the repository name and the branch name, and we have exactly supplied the same thing. You can see it here. In the configuration, we have supplied the branch name and repository name as mentioned in the documentation here. Repository name, branch name, and from different provider, the configuration are completely different. Okay, so must check this documentation before making code changes in the AWS code pipeline configuration. Okay, now similar way, you can go down and you can see here the stage is built, the name is built, the action category is the build, and in the configuration you are supplying all the environment variables. We can supply the environment variable multiple way. For the example, in the plain text, we are supplying the environment as a plain text, supplying the AWS default region as plain text. So the account ID part only I have make it secret. You can see I have supplied parameter store as the type. Now this type is very important as parameter store, and the value is the account ID. Now this account ID value should match with our AWS. Then if you go to parameter store, you can see parameter store there. You can see account ID, that account ID value, see, is not even showing, is coming from the, this account ID value coming from this parameter store. And to make this happen, make sure you have in the IAM, SSM describe parameters should be there, the SSM get parameter should be there, and the KMS decrypt part should be there. Otherwise, this will not work. Okay, go down again, and the build part, you can see supply that. In the project name, you are supplying the code build project name. Okay, you can see AWS code build project, then dot container build, container app build, that is the build project name, dot name. There is the container app build, that is the our resource name, dot name. This is how you are referencing the this our code build project. Okay, now go down again. Now see this again, here again the most important part is the provider, that is the code build. If you not sure what are the parameters, simply go to this page. This page reference already have added in my document or ebook. You can follow it there. You can see the code build here, click on that, and you can see all the available action type, the configuration parameters. And you can see, if you go down and down, you can see environment variables, and you can see environment variable, you can supply parameter store as well as a secret manager as well. So you can use either of that app. You can use the both things. Okay, just see the type here, optional. You have the valid values of parameter store, secret manager and plain text. I hope you understand this part very carefully, because this will be the most important point while you're working on the AWS CI/CD with Terraform. Okay, similarly, let's go to the very last one, that is the stage deploy. And here you can see the category also deploy, the configuration, we are mentioning the cluster name. Again, in the variables, I have supplied the cluster name, I have supplied the Node.js application service name, and the file name as image definition. Now if your file name is image definition, you can even ignore that, but if it's something else, you must mention the file name here. Okay, And if you want, you can give the deployment timeout. I just commented on, but if you really need it, you can mention it here. Okay. Then the build input artifacts is the build artifact that is we got from this. You can see output artifact from previous stage is a build artifact. In the final stage, we got the input artifacts. We got the input artifact as the build artifact. Okay. Make sure you maintain the flow. Otherwise, your application will not work. Okay. And you are mentioning the name as deploy. Owner as AWS, provider as ECS. Again, the most important part is the provider. So if you are not sure what this provider give us, simply go to here and you can see ECS here. You can see ECS and CodeDeploy plugin. Go down and you can see all the supported configuration parameter here. So application name, deployment group name, task elimination template artifact, all the details are there. So whatever your requirements are, you can work according to that. Fine. Just simple copy paste and you have created the same for the Python application and say another pipeline for the Go application. Now enough talks, let's get into action and run the commands to make it happen. So first command you should run is terraform plan. This will give you a view what will be the resource that need to be added, and it's still like a dry run. It will give you all the details. Okay, so wait for that and you can see it given all the details like what resource is going to get added as a big list. And if you're okay with that, simply run terraform apply. Simply run that and that's it. And it will ask you for the confirmation. So let's wait for that. You can see it asking for confirmation. And again, it gives you it will confirm you what are the resources going to get created. You say yes. It will take a few minutes and all your resources will be created. So code build and code pipeline, everything will get created. Let's see. Okay, so the Terraform apply is done. You can see 9 resources added and output that I have mentioned, but that's okay. And if we go to our AWS console, if we go to the code build, you will see the build project is created, container app build, as you have exactly mentioned here, right? If we go up and it is container app build project, exactly the name you have supplied, it gives you the same name. And if you go to the pipelines, you can see all pipeline created. So cool, isn't it? Now let's make a change. Let's say Node.js application, I want to make it version 2. So come to the Node.js application, and in the Node.js application, we'll make a very minor change. The index.js, we call it version 2. Okay. And let's go back and ls. Let's give it like cd node app and let's add say commit. So version 2 changes. Commit git push origin master. Okay, it's done. Now if you go to here and you can click on the node app pipeline, you can see version 2 changes and the builds now is running. Soon the build will be done, and in the right now it's 1, I think. Yes, after the build is success and all, you'll be able to see in version 2. You can see the build progress as well. If you click on details and then go to the phase details, you can see which phase it is. So submitted, code, provisioning, then is download source, and you can see pre-build also success. Now in the build phase, you can see how the build is going, the build logs. Okay, you can see it's pulling the image, then it will make start the build, and after that it will push the image in the ECI itself. So it will take few seconds. You can see build is done and it's complete. If you click on the plan page details, you can see all are complete. If you go to the pipeline, you can see node pipeline and the build and the source and the build is done. Now it will take few minutes for the deployment to happen. Okay, after that this will become version 2. Let's wait for that. So now all our code pipeline updated, and is this, see, Node.js version 2 is showing now. So that is updated. And once you are done with all this testing and all, simply go back to the Terraform infra and clear it and simply run Terraform destroy. And it is to make sure that you incur no more cost after you're done with your experimentation. Okay. And run Terraform destroy. It will take few seconds, then it will ask for the confirmation. Let's wait for that. And you can see it's showing all the resources that's going to get deleted, and say yes. And it will destroy all your resources. So you will have no more worries about like anything will going to happen. No, nothing will happen anymore. Okay. And see that this is how cool it is. Just you want to create some resources, you create it. And once you're done with that, and if you want to remove, just run a command. It's all getting deleted. So let me show you. Let's go to the console. And if you go to code pipeline, you see all are deleted. Let's go to the build and build projects. No more build. So all resources deleted. So I hope you like the session and you learned something very useful today. So if you like the session, do like this video, share this video with others. Make sure to subscribe the channel and don't forget to click on the bell icon. Hope to see you soon in my next session. Bye.